good evening, everybody, and it's just fantastic to see so many people out here tonight. So great to see a full house. So welcome to tonight's Research Tuesdays forum, Defeating Superbugs. My name's Bob Hill. I'm the Executive Dean of the Faculty of Sciences here at the University of Adelaide. I'd first like to acknowledge the Kaurna people, the original custodians of the Adelaide Plains and the land on which the university's campuses at Roseworthy, Waite and North Terrace are built. Tonight we're looking at superbugs, bacteria that cause common infections and are highly resistant to multiple classes of antibiotics and that are dangerously close to regaining the upper hand. A problem which obviously interests a lot of people, given the crowd we have here tonight. University of Adelaide researchers are working hard to reverse the trend. And in this important presentation, you'll hear their latest findings. We're going to hear from three experts, Adjunct Professor John Turnage, Professor Darren Trott, and Professor James Payton. First, they'll present individually, sharing with us some background information about current antibiotic use and resistance in humans in Australia, antibiotic use and resistance in Australia's livestock, companion animals and wildlife, and finally, the mechanisms by which superbugs cause disease and how this knowledge can guide novel vaccines and therapeutic strategies. Following the presentations, all three speakers will join me for a panel discussion, and I really would like to encourage audience participation, so we'll be looking for questions from you. And we'll delve a little deeper into some of the current issues and the possible solutions. Finally, before we start things off, I just let you know that we have a photographer here tonight for City Mag magazine. So that person, wherever they are, will be, there he is, taking photographs, thank you. So if any of you have a camera, you can take photographs of her. And so let me introduce the first speaker tonight, Adjunct Professor John Turnage. John is an infectious diseases physician and clinical microbiologist in the University of Adelaide Schools of Biological Sciences and Health Sciences. He's a senior medical advisor to the Australian Commission on Safety and Quality in Healthcare, an ongoing contributor to the Australian Government's National Antimicrobial Resistance Strategy. Please welcome John. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Thank you very much, and it's fantastic to see so many people there. I'm overwhelmed by the interest. Let me start by doing my own research. It's called social research. Hands up those who took an antibiotic in the last year. Well, we've got a pretty representative sample, as you will find out. That's a lot of people. For those of you sitting up the back, you would have seen all the arms. So what are superbugs? What I'm going to do is indulge myself by showing some of the information that I've had the privilege to gather about microbial use in Australia and how we compare ourselves with other countries, and the resistant bugs and some superbugs. That privilege given to me by the Australian Commission on Safety and Quality in Healthcare that got the contract 3.5 years ago to set up resistance and antibiotic use surveillance for the whole country. Something we've been begging for the last 20 years, of course. But of course, you've got to find the time and money to make it all happen. So what are superbugs? It's a kind of funny term. We used to joke about it, and I've got other joke slides about what are superbugs. It's so well understood, this term now. Well, simply meaning bacteria, common pathogens that are resistant to multiple antibiotics. And multiple antibiotics can mean all sorts of subtle things. But we have some favourites, and they're on this list here. These are the ones that we like to talk about. Because I work in medicine, acronyms are the go, and so they all have these four-letter words. Probably the most well-known is MRSA. Methicillin-resistant, now multi-resistant Staphylococcus aureus, or the resistant golden staph, which has made it in and out of the news for at least the last 30 years in this country. So as I said, had the fantastic privilege of being offered a job to work and set up our first national program, including naming rights. I came up with a cute name, we call it AURA, Australian antimicrobial use and resistance in Australia. It's well and truly entrenched now in the national thinking. It's an easy way to convey to everybody that we have at least one aspect of this under control. Antimicrobial resistance and antibiotics and the whole issue has an enormous number of moving parts, and they can't all be summarised in the amount of time that, me and my fellow speakers have today to speak with you and answer your questions. But there are, these are the kinds of moving parts that we're required to put together in our data pie in terms of antimicrobial use, which is up the top, antimicrobial resistance down the bottom. We needed to look in both the community and in hospitals. And the community is even more complicated because we know it comes in two parts, and we've recognised that there's a significant antimicrobial resistance reservoir in nursing homes, residential aged care facilities. And we need to gather our information in two different ways. What's once called passive surveillance, in other words, going out and capturing data that already exists for another purpose, but answers questions about use or resistance. And then targeted surveillance, where you need to spend extra bucks to find out the specific information about specific pathogens. All of that is now in place. And these are the kinds of bits and pieces required to make all this happen. As it turned out, we already had many of these bits and pieces, they just weren't coordinated. And it's taken 3 years to get them to work together, all of these different data sources. And you can see the kinds of institutions around the country that are ending up making significant contributions in Queensland Health, SA Health, UniSA, not just Adelaide University, and the people you're seeing here today who are contributing to the whole national picture. So let's look at the resistance problems. I showed you some names, some bacterial names, and some particular superbugs that we're interested in and causing problems for us on an everyday basis. What I'm going to show you over the next few slides are those superbugs that particularly concern us and for which we have comparative data. These are data generated in Australia with the orange bar and generated in Europe in exactly the same way. They're actually bacteria that are isolated from blood cultures. So these people have septicemia. This is the sharp end of antibiotic resistance. This is where you live or die, depending on whether you get the right treatment or not, or whether antibiotic resistant to the treatment that you're getting. So let's look at this one, fluoroquinolone resistant E. coli, and we can see that we're doing extremely well with E. coli and with Pseudomonas, and we're only out done by our colleagues in Iceland and Finland. A similar kind of situation for what is called third-generation cephalosporin-resistant E. coli. These are the resistant to second- and third-line agents that we use in hospital for treating patients who are seriously ill. And again, not quite as good as we were with the fluoroquinolones, but getting up there. And still doing considerably better than most European countries. When we move on to what's called the gram-positive side of the bacterial spectrum, we don't look so good. We've had multi-resistant, methicillin-resistant Staph aureus in this country in plague proportions on the East Coast since the late 1970s. And the situation has not improved. It's completely transformed, but it hasn't improved. Originally, this bug was just a hospital bug and it was plaguing hospitals. And then we ruled out it wasn't an it was a them, and there are different varieties of it. And now we have the capacity to track exactly what's happening. And since about 2000, we're seeing more and more of a problem with this bug in the community. Totally different strains from the ones in the hospital. In fact, the hospital ones are going away. But instead, we've replaced them by creating these monsters out in the community. And something we are not proud of at all. This is vancomycin-resistant enterococcus, first described in Europe, then took hold in northeast United States, became a big issue, and arrived in Australia rather late, and then has taken off and outdoes any country in Europe. This is just a hospital bug, but it's a very hard to treat hospital bug. It's not one you want to get. It hits the most vulnerable people, people having cancer chemotherapy, people having liver transplants, people who are whose immune systems are particularly damaged. We're literally down to last line antibiotics when we have to treat this particular organism. And we don't like being up here. We don't have any easy way out of it. It's probably turned out to be one of the hardest bugs to control in hospitals anywhere in the world. But why we have a worse problem than others, we don't know. As part of setting up our ORIS National Surveillance Program in Human Health, we were also asked to set up a national alert system. And that national alert system was literally for getting those super bugs, you might call them, the ones that really are resistant to everything but the very last line of antibiotics, or even sometimes resistant to those as well. We sat around in darkened room and worked out which are the ones that are going to trouble us the most. We had a lot of help from the rest of the world because the rest of the world is having these problems too. So this is much as what you would see in Europe or the US in terms of resistance, these critical resistances, as we call them. And now we've been tracking them for not a year. We have data, consolidated data for the first 9 months, and we can tell how many of these super bugs are coming into Australia. You won't understand all these codes, but they stand for the kinds of resistance mechanisms that trouble us greatly. These ones in particular, these four here and combinations of it, are the ones that worry us greatly because they make E. coli resistant to our favourite last line antibiotic. So they are coming into Australia. In fact, the blue ones are established in Australia, and we have evidence that they've probably been established in Australia for about 30 years. We don't get too many in Adelaide, but they're there, and they're usually brought in from interstate, as you can see where most of them are in the eastern states. The ones that get the press are the green ones. Stands for New Delhi metallobetalactamase. These usually come with at least a resistance to at least 5 to 8 other classes of antibiotics. And there's only one regular antibiotic that's used for treatment, and resistance to that was described coming out of China only a year and a half ago. So, and we don't even have proper mechanisms in our lab to make sure that we detect it every time, but we know it usually comes with these other resistances, so we know where to look. Why do we have all this resistance? Well, one of the most important reasons that we have resistance is that we use antibiotics. We want to use antibiotics. We want to cure a bacterial infection. We can't avoid resistance because as soon as you start using antibiotics, there will be some resistance. Our job is to minimise it. And the principal job is to minimise the use of antibiotics, giving it to only those people who desperately need it. We haven't done that. When penicillin arrived, discovered by a guy called Fleming and developed by an Adelaide citizen for a while of at least 22 years of his life, Howard Florey, that became the miracle drug and everybody wanted access, and that's what's ended up happening. Everybody around the world has access to antibiotics, and access has turned into excess. It's a very sad state of affairs. It's a social phenomenon as much as anything else, and you'll get to see that in a moment. This graph shows our use on the pharmaceutical benefit scheme, which captures about 95% of all antibiotic use in Australia now, and shows us that we have fairly high use of antibiotics, and if you just count total antibiotic prescriptions, they exceed 30 million every year. There's only 24 million of us, so we take more than one course of antibiotics per capita every year. That's a pretty interesting figure. Do we actually need that? As you will see, the answer is no. Do we prescribe well in this country? Do we consume antibiotics well in this country? And the answer is no. There's only one non-red figure of percentage prescribing that fits the acceptable range of antibiotic use in this country, in the community. And that's the treatment of pneumonia, because doctors are good at recognising it and treating it and getting it right. But we're over-prescribing in all of these other areas, or at least prescribing the non-recommended antibiotics. How do we compare with other countries? Well, we're not the worst in the world. And in fact, if you look at OECD figures, the worst in the world looks like something like Turkey, but it's only marginally ahead of Greece. But look where we are. We're up with the Greeks and the hot-headed Latins. We would like to be down with the boring old Dutch and the Scandinavians. Some have contained their antibiotic use over many years to a point where they can keep their citizens safe and healthy without all that antibiotic prescribing. So look at the Dutch, which I kind of use as my mental benchmark. It's 11 so-called divine daily doses per 1,000 inhabitants per day. In Australia, we're up above 25. Are the Dutch dying like flies of untreated bacterial infection? Not that I can see. Do they get the same diseases as us? Sure they do. So it's not easy to explain other than this has become part of our culture. And it's part of our culture that needs to change. And it is changing in some places. We now have national programs promoted by a hospital accreditation to change antibiotic prescribing and reduce inappropriate prescribing in hospitals. And we're starting to see the benefits of that as that rolled out over the last 5 years. And they continue to roll out more and more particularly into the private sector, which is now picking up and running with this. And we can see that we don't do quite so badly with our antibiotic prescribing in hospital. Why are we doing better in hospitals? Well, that's where all the microbiologists and infectious diseases physicians are, who are passionate about making a change, people like myself. But we can always do better, and we have now a system in place where hospitals can check how well they're doing and find out whether they make any of their stewardship initiatives in the hospital are actually making a difference. And there's still room for improvement. We do have a national strategy, as Bob said. Ultimately, we have made a commitment. It's taken a long time to get there. There was an animal called Jetacar, which a committee that I chaired back in the late 1990s, that made recommendations that were endorsed by government at the turn of the millennium, and then it all fizzled out. It's very hard to get political will to stick in this particular subject, despite its importance and its prominence in the media. Hopefully you will get inspired to think about it and make a difference somewhere into the future. Thank you very much.
Thank you, John. Now I'd like to introduce Professor Darren Trott. Darren is Professor of Veterinary Microbiology at the Roseworthy campus. In 2016, he became Director of the University of Adelaide's Australian Centre for Antimicrobial Resistance Ecology, which undertakes antimicrobial resistance surveillance, researches the ecology and evolution of antimicrobial resistance in human, animal and zoonotic pathogens, and develops and repurposes new classes of antibiotics. Thank you, Darren.
Thanks, Bob, and thanks to my colleagues here as well. It's with their encouragement and assistance that we've been able to develop the centre. Are we all good? Okay. I'd just like to start by giving you a few slides. There we go. I'd like to start by just giving a few slides that I present to the animal industries and the veterinarians. If you look at people that produce animals, particularly livestock in Australia, they're concerned about two things. They're concerned about the welfare of their animals and the profitability of their business. And antibiotics have been important in that. What we are now seeing is them looking at the ecological consequences of inappropriate antibiotic use. So John certainly mentioned the contribution of our alma mater, Baron Howard Florey. And I like the point where he said the development of penicillin was a team effort, as these things tend to be. Defeating superbugs is a team effort, and it's between all end users of antibiotics, and that means human and veterinary. And we combine together and we call that One Health. And that's really what our centre's all about. It's to find solutions and to work with everybody at all levels, stakeholders, and you, the public, as well. You can see the dramatic effect of penicillin in this child over a course of days, from close to death through to full recovery. And I also like to use this little cartoon, which is a great little song. If you grew up where I grew up, you know this song particularly well. And with a droplet of ampicillin there, our little guy here, he's singing at the end of the world. Is it the end of the world for his friends, the bugs? Or is it the end of the world because he is resistant and he feels fine? And the illustrator's been very, very clever. Note these guys have got all the same bacterial chromosomal DNA, but he's got this little bit of red DNA there, which is his plasmid containing the antibiotic resistance gene. And that is what drives resistance, and that plasmid moves around and acquires resistances as well. Okay, if we look at the ecological consequences, if we do nothing about antibiotic resistance, it's predicted to cause 10 million deaths per year. And here are the breakdowns per continent there in terms of that area, at a combined cost of about $100 trillion. That's been worked out by a UK economist. And that's why we've got this really big issue now, that everyone suddenly realised, we're running out of new antibiotics. If we don't slow the rate of resistance development now, we could be dealing back to being in the 1930s in that pre-penicillin age. And we often demonise the pharmaceutical companies, but if you look at their funding models, you know, there's absolutely no money, or there used to be absolutely no money in developing an antibiotic, a great amount of public good. But you can see here the drop over those years in the number of companies investing in new antibiotics. At the same time, we've seen the rise in examples of three organisms, and two of those John has already talked about now, MRSA and VRE. So there's been a bit of a big stimulation back to try to get these companies to develop new antibiotics. And we've seen the machine sort of build up now. And now there's a lot of research going on, but it's almost a bit too little too late. It may take 10 to 20 years to get these new antibiotics on the market. And in the meantime, we've got to make the best use of what we've got. Now, when we look at all of that, the other perfect storm scenario is that with population growth and the requirement for high quality protein, we're going to see an increase in the amount of antibiotics used on a global level. This has been estimated in a recent paper to be about 67%, and it's mainly being driven by poultry production in China and India and pig production in China. And we know that in some of those countries, the antibiotic use regulations aren't so good. And certainly, we're going to need to really look at the way we use antibiotics in animals as an absolute last resort as we go forward. Okay, so if we look at Australia now, we're in a very lucky situation with our animal production. We have a large reliance on extensive rangelands as opposed to intensive livestock production. And I'll give you some examples of that, both our cattle and our sheep production. We also have an import ban on fresh meat and live animals. That's very different to many other countries. That gives us a protective advantage. We do have some frozen product for small good production, and that really hurts our producers. So certainly they want to be able to sort of fight back on an international scale, and our low antimicrobial footprint is one of those ways. We're free of many of the diseases that drive the use of antibiotics in other countries, and we put that into our strict quarantine laws. That's the reason why we've got border security, is to prevent these new agents coming into the country. Our geographic isolation and no common land borders are natural advantages. The only way we can get new bugs coming into animals is through people or migratory birds, and those are very significant. The last thing has been the most important, and we really have to thank John. The restriction of fluoroquinolones in human medicine was also seen in animals, and we are the only country that's never allowed the use of fluoroquinolones in food-producing animals. It's a tremendous advantage that we're not really seeing us get the benefits of that. All of these other important last-line drugs are not used in food-producing animals. Colistin, we know, is used in other countries and has been associated with the emergence of a resistance gene, particularly in China, where it's been used in humans and animals. The last one, of course, and John has mentioned the third-generation cephalosporins, we have no use of those in poultry. That's very different to other countries. We do have some label constraints. They can only be used for respiratory disease in cattle, but we do have what we call off-label use as well. That's if a veterinarian has an infection in another food animal species that can't be treated with the registered drugs with label indications, they can use this off-label. And I think that's the only thing we really need to concentrate on and make sure we do that right. Okay, this is a picture that I took 13 years ago in Vietnam. I worked in Vietnam for over 10 years, off and on, where we were improving smallholder pig production, helping poor rural farmers increase their livelihood. And when I first went there, I was shocked. I was taken to this little piggery out in the middle of nowhere, and this is what they were using for when they had diarrhea in their pigs. It's a fluoroquinolone. And that's what every little pig had when it had diarrhea, regardless of whether they knew what the cause was or not. So some of the first antibiotic stewardship we did that back then was to completely remove this from their production system. We also made a locally produced vaccine that controlled most of the diarrhea. And we were able to improve our pig production from 10 pigs up to 20. It was a very successful program, but I've never forgot this image. And that's 13 years ago, and this is a drug that is not used in food producing, in any food producing animal in Australia. So that might give you some of the scale, the advantage we have in Southeast Asia, and how I think getting food, getting fresh food in Southeast Asia is going to be one of our industries in the future. Not to feed the world, but the high quality product that's produced with low antibiotics. John showed some data on our antibiotic usage in humans in Australia and compared that to the world. This is our estimation based on data, and we have to be careful when looking at the data because we have to correct for the size of the animal, the amount of antibiotic you have to give a cow versus a chicken. And that's what this little graph shows. We can see it varies greatly in Europe, and we're sort of sitting with the Scandinavian countries that we know have implemented low antimicrobial use policy and regular surveillance for the last 20 years. What we haven't done in Australia is, you know, we thought we were going to get it after John's Jeddakar report, but it fizzled. We had a little pilot program back in 2003 and nothing on a national basis until now. We're now re-entering that area, and our research group is looking at not only the gram-negative surveillance in humans, but also we're looking at that in animals with the first studies, and I'll show you some of those results. Just to give you a few success stories, this is the salmon industry. It's a very growing industry. They can't meet the demand for fresh product. It's a North Atlantic species that has come to Tasmanian waters, and suddenly, boom, a new lot of bacterial diseases that you haven't seen in the North American hatcheries or fisheries. So when the industry first started, a lot of antibiotic use, but you've seen how much that's dropped over the years, down to only a tiny amount of use in the hatchery stage. They're saying very little antibiotics is used when the animals are growing in these giant sea cages. And that is predominantly due to the introduction of very effective vaccines. Yes, we vaccinate fish, they go along a line and you inject them when they're little, and off they go, and it works. So a very successful strategy there. This is a picture of the Channel Country around the Diamantina River there. A very successful company is raising cattle out there, and they're calling them organic cattle. Yes, they are, because they're not treated with anything, and then they round them up and they can sell them as organic produce. About two-thirds of our cattle production in Australia is grass-fed, and about one-third is lot-fed. We do need to use antibiotics in lot-fed, though what I'm really amazed about when I started looking at the industry is our vets don't treat every animal, say, coming into the feedlot as a preventative. They really try to identify the sick animals and direct that attention very well. So, and one of the techniques they use here is this electronic stethoscope that they can pick up respiratory disease very, very quickly and treat the animals early, try to reduce the number of animal treatments, look at management strategies. And that's certainly been borne out in the MLA did a surveillance study They looked at what healthy animals were carrying at slaughter, and they looked at grass-fed compared to lop-fed, and the resistance levels were about the same. They were very low across all species, and that is quite different than some of our studies done internationally. Okay, oops, sorry, back to a favourite group of mine, and that's pigs. Out of all the livestock species, I'm not going to mention much about poultry, only to say that our poultry systems in Australia rely more on biosecurity and vaccines than antibiotics. But in pigs, we still use quite a deal of antibiotics. The industry is definitely wanting to reduce the level of antibiotics it uses. And this is some of the systems that they've developed. This is an eco-shelter. It would be great to have pigs out in the field in Australia, but they get sunburnt. Okay, and this is a nice little eco-shelter, so it's covering the pigs here. This is a deep litter system. It's what we call an all-in-all-out system. The pigs go in all at the same age, and then when they leave that system, it's all cleaned out and disinfected, ready for the next area. And this has been a very good system to control some diseases, but not others. Now imagine you've got a couple of sick pigs there, and if you just run through that pig, try to capture those sick ones and give them an antibiotic, you're going to stress all the other ones out, and you're going to create more infections the next day when you go back. So that's why antibiotics in the feed or water at key stages, very young animals often are treated with antibiotics, and the industry is trying whatever it can to move away from that system. We've got some very successful use of probiotics. And one I'd like to highlight, a South Australian company that we've been working with, Ecos4, we're trialling, they've got a very novel safe sanitizer that they use in food. We're trialling it as an aerosol disinfectant to prevent transfer of respiratory disease between pigs rather than treating them with antibiotics. So that's one that we're really investing in quite heavily at the moment. Okay, so I wanted to then just tell you about the antibiotic resistance surveillance that we've done. This is a pilot project in pigs. It just shows that for those critically important antimicrobial agents, that we have ceftiofur, ceftriaxone, ciprofloxacin, colistin, virtually no levels of resistance turning up in our pigs. These are healthy pigs at slaughter. We also look at salmonella. So this is our first pilot study on a national basis, and very little resistance. The pig industry was very brave to be the first ones involved in this situation, and we can certainly see that they are very happy with the results, but they're not resting on their laurels. They want to drive that situation even further. We also look at pathogens that cause infections in animals, and this allows us to do a little bit of apples and oranges comparison with what we see in human medicine. Companion animals, I haven't spent a lot talking about companion animals, but they're very much treated almost the same way that we see humans treated. And if we look at our critically important antibiotics here, we've got very equivalent levels of resistance in our animals and in humans, but very low levels of resistance in livestock. It's a good base, but we're not happy there. We're seeing the first emergence of this resistance to third-generation cephalosporins, and we certainly want to keep that low or get it reduced even further. Okay, the last thing I'm going to finish on is, who's seen a street cat named Bob, the film? Unfortunately, I've got a story about a street cat named Frank, and it's not as good as Bob's story. Poor Frank, this is an actor, this is not Frank. We've concealed his identity. But this just goes to show the ecological consequences of antibiotics and maybe some of the other things that we do in the environment. Poor Frank was a Sydney street cat. His owner surrendered him to a shelter. He had a cold, and then he developed a secondary bacterial infection. The vet did a test on him, showed it was bacterial, put him on an upper respiratory tract antibiotic. And unfortunately, after that antibiotic treatment, he got really sick. He got diarrhea with blood in it. He got a temperature, he was very morose, and he was rushed back to the veterinary clinic. So this is what we call shelter medicine. And our cat shelters do an amazing job, and a lot of the donations to cat shelters is used to give them treatment. Poor Frank, unfortunately, he passed away. He had to be euthanized because in his actual feces, he had a multi-resistant salmonella. And this multi-resistant salmonella is something we'd never seen before in the animal area. It's actually carrying that carbapenemase that John has been talking about before that's on the east coast of Australia. How did Frank pick this up? Well, this is a plasmid when we've sequenced the entire genes. And what you can see here is all the antibiotic resistance genes on this circular plasmid. Over this side, we've got heavy metal resistance genes as well. We think that heavy metals are also a selection pressure in the environment. How did Frank pick this up? Well, this plasmid is very similar to what we see in human isolates. It's been picked up in China. It's also been picked up in seagulls. Did Frank eat a seagull? We don't know. But just to bring it back to talking about use in animals, what's the greater risk for me, sharing my fish and chips with a seagull or eating a lovely piece of juicy Australian pork? I'd take the pork every time. Okay, but anyway, more research in this area about why these seagulls are picking it up and what's happening is there in the future. So I'll conclude. These are a few mantras we like to go with. As little as possible, as much as necessary, is important for animal health. We need to reduce our antibiotics. All antimicrobials are not created equal. If we avoid the use of the critically important ones in human medicine, we're fine. We're all swimming in the same gene pool. Certainly these resistance genes move around, and we've seen that in Frank, the shelter cat. And also, if I'm up here saying that we don't have some issues in the veterinary area, you know, I'm lying. And I think we do need to be focused on our third generation cephalosporin use. It's the only one of the critically important drugs that we use. Lastly, the benefits of sharing our microbes with our animals far outweigh the risks, and some practices should be discouraged.
Thanks, Darren. I didn't know we could vaccinate fish on such a large scale. Thank you. Finally, I'd like to introduce Professor James Payton. James directs the University of Adelaide's Research Centre for Infectious Diseases. Also, as a National Health and Medical Research Council Senior Principal Research Fellow, he's authored over 350 publications in international scientific journals, including landmark papers in Nature, Science and Nature Medicine. Through his work and research, James has attracted over $80 million in research funding during his career. Welcome, James.
Okay, it's a bit better, isn't it? Okay, we're going to talk about what can we do about some of these issues that arise from increasing rates of multiply resistant bacteria. We need a two-pronged approach here. One of them is to improve preventative strategies, and this can be something as simple from a scientific point of view as better housing and sanitation, particularly in developing countries. In the 20th century, engineers probably saved more lives from infectious diseases than microbiologists and infectious diseases specialists ever did. Stop people getting ill, they don't need the antibiotic. We can also look at new and improved vaccines and make sure that vaccines which are available are being utilised to their full extent. And collectively, those two things reduce the overall need for antimicrobials, and if you're using fewer antimicrobials, as we've seen in these earlier examples, then you reduce the selective pressure for evolution and transmission of resistance genes in the bacterial community. But the other thing we need to do also is to really have a good crack at developing some new antimicrobials. And one of the problems with most of the antibiotics which are in use today is that they're derived from naturally occurring compounds. Antibiotics, the very first ones, were produced by one microbe to knock off its competition in whatever environment it was hanging out in. And so this means if that microbe isn't going to be killed by its own weaponry, then it has to have a resistance mechanism to detoxify the drug, or it's changed some of its targets within itself such that it's not susceptible. So by definition, genes that encode resistance already exist if you're using a naturally occurring antimicrobial, antibiotic. And so maybe we've got to think about making sure that we develop completely new drugs, because if we're using drugs which are derived from natural substances, then in all probability the resistance is there, and as soon as you start using that, you simply start to turn on the selective pressure for its dissemination. I'll give you a couple of examples of the sort of things which we've been doing in my lab and also in my collaborators' labs. And we work on this bug called Streptococcus pneumoniae, which was one of the people, one of the organisms which was on the first slide, for one of the earlier slides in John's presentation. I think this is sort of the world's sort of foremost bacterial pathogen in terms of sort of scale of death and death and disease. It causes things like pneumonia, septicemia and meningitis, all of which are life-threatening, but also very, very common infection, otitis media, which is middle ear infections. And this is one of the commonest, otitis media is one of the commonest reasons for children being taken to see the doctor and one of the commonest reasons for prescription of antibiotics, just as upper respiratory and lower respiratory infections, which the pneumococcus causes, is also a very strong driver of antibiotic use. And collectively, this bug at the moment is killing somewhere between 2 and 3 million people each year, principally in children under 5 and the over 65s. There's problems with resistance, increasing rates of resistance to multiple antimicrobials. We've got a vaccine, and it's now widely used. It's part of the National Immunisation Program for children in Australia and many parts of the world, those parts of the world that can afford it, because it's fairly expensive. The problem we've got is that this vaccine is highly effective against the 13 out of 93 different serotypes of strep pneumoniae, which are covered by the vaccine. And you can't increase the number greater than about 13 without losing efficacy of the ones which are included. So we've got a problem that was a vaccine which protects well against the 13 commonest of the 93 known serotypes. But what's happened is it's with widespread use of this vaccine, we're just getting increased prevalence of disease caused by the strains, the serotypes, which are not included. It's fairly obvious. They've now got a selective advantage. And also, this vaccine is not particularly effective against otitis media. It's not as good as it is, it's not as effective as it is against the systemic disease. So, ideally, we want a vaccine which can protect against all strains and also all disease types. And that's one of the things which my lab's been working on for a number of years. We were focusing not on the components of the current vaccine, which was a capsular polysaccharide, was one of the outer coatings of the pneumococcus. And it's that capsular polysaccharide which differs among the 93 serotypes. We were looking at proteins produced by the pneumococcus, which are expressed, are either released into the extracellular environment or displayed on the surface of the microorganism, which can be a target for an immune system if we put them into the vaccine. And these ones, one of them, for example, pneumolysoid, is a genetically detoxified form of a toxin produced by pneumococcus, which we've been working on since the early 1980s. And these other surface proteins called CBPA and PSPA are displayed on the surface of the organism and are good targets for vaccines. And the antibodies will neutralise the toxin and help clear the organism. And we've found that if we have a combination of these three components in a vaccine, then we'll get good protection against all serotypes, and we're able to get protection against the full spectrum of pneumococcal infections, at least in our animal models. And these components of these are now in about phase two clinical trials. The other type of vaccine which we've been working on in more recent years is really going back to the past. Pasteur, when he first developed vaccines, all he did was take a bug which was causing a disease, kill it with heat or chemical treatment and injected it into the subject, and that raised antibody responses. But when you use those crude sort of killing mechanisms, you actually change the surface structure of the bacteria. And so when you use those sort of chemically or heat-killed vaccines, the antibodies which are raised against it by the host aren't a particularly good fit anymore for the actual live version of the bacterium. Working with our colleague Mohammed Al-Sharifi, we've found that using gamma irradiation to kill one of these whole cell vaccines makes it completely safe to administer, but the gamma irradiation, unlike heating or chemical detoxification, doesn't actually change the surface structures at all. And so you've now got a perfectly safe, very cheap to produce vaccine, which elicits very good antibody responses and also cell-mediated immune responses. And that's effective against, again, all serotypes and all disease types. So that's a couple of things that we've been up to. The other area that we wanted to, that we've been sort of dabbling with over the years has been development of potential novel antimicrobial drugs. Now, this is not really our core business. Our core business is studying mechanisms of bacterial pathogenesis. What does the bug do in order to cause disease? How does it survive in the host environment? But that sort of information is really critical first step if you're going to develop novel drug targets. You've got to understand what the bug has to do in order to survive in the host environment. And then, having done that, you can select one of these targets, and then you've got a couple of ways of developing drugs against it. You can do a sort of a random screening. There's sort of chemical compound libraries available with, you know, 30, 40,000 different chemical compounds, and you can test every single one of them until you find one which works. Or you can sort of do a slightly smarter approach and build on that with a bit of structurated drug design. And I'll just give you an example now, which is sort of we've been doing with our colleagues in the University of Queensland. So first of all, choose the target. Now, some of our research, going back over a decade now, we found that pneumococci desperately need the metal, manganese, in order to survive in the host environment, because the manganese is needed for enzymes like superoxide dismutase, which protects the bacterium against the killing mechanisms of host white blood cells. So how does it get manganese? Manganese is normally fairly scarce in the host environment, and so it needs very, very high efficiency uptake systems called ABC permeases. And the one for manganese is called PSA. And that composed of three components. There's this extracellular protein called PSAA, and this is a high efficiency manganese binding protein. And here we've got the surface membrane of the bacterium. So that's the outside and that's the inside of the bacterium there. The second component is this permease, which forms a pore between the membrane, which can open and close, driven by hydrolysis of ATP. So this is the energy for the system here. And so when ATP is hydrolyzed by this one, the energy released can open and close that pore, and that allows the manganese, which is delivered by the PSAA into this channel, to be released on the inside. Now, any of those components are absolutely essential for virulence of the bacterium, that is its capacity to kill. So in a mouse model, if we take mice and sort of infect them intranasally with wild-type Streptococcus pneumoniae, median survival time is about 3 days. On the other hand, if we take a strain of Strep pneumoniae and specifically delete either the B gene, the C gene, or the A gene, so either that, or that, the bacterium and challenge use those mutants to infect the mice, those mutants can no longer cause any disease whatsoever, even though we're putting very large doses into the nasopharynx of the mouse. So clearly, this is by definition, this system is an ideal drug target. And the obvious one to go for is this one here, because that's the one that's on the outside of the bacterial cell. And so we don't have to worry about getting a new antibiotic inside the bacterial cell in order to hit it. So we can get it out there in the environment. So how do we go about doing it? Well, first of all, we need to have a good idea as to what is that, you know, what does the target look like? So this is, in fact, a diagram showing the three-dimensional structure of the PSAA molecule, which we solved with our colleagues at the University of Queensland. And it's a bit of a hybrid sort of model. out there, you can see sort of the frame, this, all those bitty sticks showing the framework of the amino acids which go to make up this particular protein. And just the part there, we've used space-filling software to sort of show you what the surface of the protein actually looks like, rather than all those confusing sticks. And you can see that there's this deep cleft going down the centre of the protein with a nice hole there, and that's the manganese binding site. And so what we want are drugs which can sit in here and either stop manganese from being bound by the protein or alternatively stop the manganese from being released and delivered to the permeate so it can't get inside the cell. And so we use the sort of in silico screening, and this is software which I simply can't understand, and so we leave this to our experts up at UQ. And so the idea here is that you do it all on a computer. You don't test any of these 30,000 or more sort of small, you know, fragment, what they call fragments, very small molecules. But you get the computer to go through this huge library and to pick out a couple of hundred or so, which the computer thinks ought to be able to dock into that cleft, like it's shown about 20 or 30 of them all piled up on top of each other in there. So it's pulling out, the computer software is pulling out molecules which it thinks can make the right sort of connections with all of the amino acids which are going to make up that cleft. And so when you've got reduced, when you've reduced the numbers down to just a couple of hundred to screen, now you can test them in the laboratory for their capacity to inhibit the activity of the PSAA protein. And here's results for 50 different fragments which were tested at the one concentration at 100 micromolar. And you can see here, up the vertical axis, we've got percent PSAA inhibition. And we've got a couple of molecules which have got sort of 20% or more inhibition of the PSAA protein. And so these are what you would call sort of lead molecules. They're not good enough on their own, but you can do things, you try and do things with them to make them more effective. You can then go back to the computer software and you now take those drugs and look at them one at a time and you see how it's binding to the amino acids. So this is the test drug here in the orange stick configuration, and then behind it is the surface of the PSAA. Now this is right in the manganese binding pocket. There's a histidine there at 139, another histidine, I think where's histidine at 67. These are the two of the critical amino acids for coordinating and binding the manganese. And so this one here is just sort of sticking into that binding pocket. This molecule down here is also in exactly the same place. There's that critical histidine there and the other histidine there. So this one's sitting over the top of the metal binding pocket. So now you can work out what sort of little groups you can add on to that original lead molecule to improve hydrogen bonding to some of these other amino acids in the binding pocket, and try and improve the strength of the interaction between this sort of lead drug and the PSAA protein. So now you can see that you can get now up around 90% or so inhibition at the concentration where previously you only got about 15%. And so you've improved the capacity of these lead molecules to inhibit the activity of PSAA, and also you can now show that it can actually inhibit growth of the whole bacterium itself. So here you've got a growth curve. This is simply culture density up on that axis, and with time you see normal bacterial growth in the absence of drugs. And then at either low concentration or high concentration, we're seeing the complete inhibition of growth by these two lead molecules. So we can conclude really is the fact that, you know, these metal uptake proteins such as PSAA are ideal targets for novel drugs. The good thing about them is that they've got a high degree of structural identity between different bacterial species, even quite unrelated bacteria. When you start to drill down and look at the three-dimensional structure of their manganese transporters, they're almost identical. And so a drug which sits into the binding pocket of PSAA from Streptococcus pneumoniae has got a very good chance of having equal activity against the manganese binding proteins from even gram-negative bacteria, quite unrelated bugs. And so we expect a broad spectrum activity. The other thing also is that when you blockade PSAA, it doesn't actually kill the bacteria, but it makes them completely unable to cause disease. And so because you're not actually killing the bacterium, you're probably reducing the selective pressure for evolution of resistance. And so that may be an additional advantage of using these sorts of approaches. Okay, well, thank you. We'll leave it at that.
Thanks, James. Now, we have time for some questions. If I could ask the three speakers to come out the front and join me here. We do have some microphones that we can wander around. Maybe I'll start. Okay, we'll put one up into the audience as well if we can. Oh, there's some. Okay. If I could start, John, you showed us that maybe inside hospitals the use of antibiotics is at an acceptable level, but Australia overall is in pretty poor shape. Has something gone wrong with our training of GPs, or is there some... I mean, what is the issue that obviously they're hiding behind use of antibiotics as a sort of point of first call?
Yeah, look, it's a very interesting and challenging question. we probably ended up with this unholy alliance between the public and the prescriber in our communities, and it's a very hard one to unwrap. It probably started in the 1950s. It started a long time ago. And so trying to turn around, it's like trying to turn around the Titanic. You would ask yourself, why would, as a general practitioner, you would prescribe antibiotics knowing they're not going to help? And we can base that on the fact that, let's say, the Dutch have the right rate of prescribing. They think they prescribe too many antibiotics themselves. But that's so there would at least half of the antibiotics that are used in Australia are unnecessary. Is that possible? Well, we already know that 75% of them are used for respiratory tract infection, and guess what? 95% of them are viral. Antibiotics don't work against viruses. The logic is pretty there. That's where it's all going, being used unnecessarily. But we don't have treatments for colds. We don't have it. People feel like they need a treatment, and I think we've got into this difficult situation. It's hard to unravel.
Thank you.
Mark Boyd, University of Adelaide. James, actually, thank you to all of you for terrific presentations. But you had a very nice demonstration there of finding a target for a new antibiotic. But of course, as we know, you need then to give it to someone who can take that to scale, to also test it and then take it to scale to be useful. And John showed some data showing that, in fact, you know, drug companies have realised that actually they're not going to make enough, they're not going to make money out of these agents that will be used for short periods of time, and almost certainly with a, if that were a, you know, a new and valuable agent, it would be kept back.
Yeah.
And we would use other agents preferably because that's so valuable, and therefore there's no return, you know, traditional pharmaceutical company where you need a return on investment. So how do we get to that stage?
I think that's a $64,000 question. I think the whole sort of economics of drug development do not favour development of new antimicrobials. As you say, if you get one which works it's not going to be licensed for general use, and yet if it's being done by the corporate sector with their own capital, it's going to cost them perhaps $200-400 million to take it through trials, possibly even more.
And $700 million.
$700 million, and probably
US.
Yeah. and for every 10 drugs which they take right through the trial process, they're lucky if one of them, they're doing brilliantly if one of them actually gets licensed and is then used. And so until they've made probably $5 or $6 billion of profit, they've lost money. And so the conventional, you know, capitalist system, if you want to call it that, does not work for development of antimicrobials. It doesn't work for vaccines either. So we've got a broken model, and governments so far simply have not been willing to put in the sorts of money necessary to take new antibiotics forward, and yet we've had figures of, you know, how many trillion dollars is going to be the economic cost of multi-drug resistance in a few years' time. Somebody needs to, as I say, redirect some serious money.
Perhaps if I could ask Darren a question while we're getting the... There's a one over here. Yeah. Darren, antibiotics have often been mentioned as being used as growth promoters in food-producing animals. Is that still going on? And if it occurs, does that impact on human health?
It's a good question. It's a good question, and one that I didn't really touch on in my 15-minute seminar. It's been very different in different countries. If you look at, say, the drugs here in Australia that have a registered claim for increasing growth, there's about five or six of them. Most of them are what we call animal-only antibiotics. They have no analogues in human medicine. They don't cause resistance in human medicine. There is one, I think, that's a macrolide called Tylosin, but the makers of that have changed that that label claim on it. As you've probably seen from my talk, I'm more concerned about shared class drugs, and particularly the critically important ones. And certainly, you know, if we look at the old story, the Jeddakar story that John was very much a part of, that came about because an antibiotic used as a growth promoter, known as avapacin, was structurally similar to vancomycin. Having said that, the USA, I was horrified to learn a few years ago, is still using clinically important antibiotics at low levels for growth promotion. And if you see a lot of the US, what's happening in the US is that growth promotion claim is coming out. So I don't think it's a big issue here in Australia. It may have been an issue overseas, but it is definitely a historical issue as well.
What is the role of macrophages in control of some of these bacterium, rather than just only use of antibiotics? And what work perhaps is being done in Australia?
The use of, sorry, I missed the...
Which? Macrophages?
Macrophages. As a treatment. I can't quite visualise how that would work.
Bacteriophages, perhaps?
Oh, phages, you mean. Bacteriophages. Right, got it. Very good question. There's been an enormous amount of research done in Georgia. and for some reason that country has specialised in that particular subject, and there's been a few people trying to do it around the world. It still has potential, but guess what? There are strains that are susceptible to bacteriophages and some that are not susceptible to bacteriophage. And in a sense, we're facing the same problem that James alluded to earlier. Because antibiotics are largely come from natural products, and those have been produced by fungi and some aerobic actinomycetes, all of which have been around for about a billion years, there's been a lot of adaptation to those things, and bacteriophage, which are the viruses that eat bacteria, are in the same category. They've been fighting bacteria, and bacteria have been fighting back for a very long time. So ultimately it might be part of the armamentarium, but it'll never be the solution.
I suppose the other issue with bacteriophages is they tend to be fairly narrow spectrum of activity. And so you'd be needing to put in a cocktail of phages in the hope of covering, to cover all of the salmonella, if it's a salmonella infection which is being treated, for example. If you don't know what the target or the infectious agent is, then you're going to have to put in a huge cocktail of these phages.
There's certainly some applications in animals where they've been used effectively in aquaculture. Certainly Professor Mary Barton, who is well known here in the Adelaide community, has been researching this area for a while. But once again, I'm probably in John's camp that it's definitely a solution worth looking at, but it wouldn't be the final solution.
I had two simple questions. First, for the first speaker, why is a positive bacteria test not required before a GP writes a script for an antibiotic? And the other question I had was that we heard a lot about the antimicrobial approach. What about the sort of crowd them out with good bacteria approach to treating resistant bugs?
Yes, thank you. It's a very good question, but it gets to the nub of the problem. We can take a test, but it'll get you 2 days to get the answer back. You want to get better now, and in fact, the antibiotics are going to work best at the beginning of the infection, not in the middle or the end of it. It's just, we have wonderful laboratories called microbiology laboratories, but we haven't got, if you like, the swizzle stick test that the GP can do and say, aha, you've got a urinary tract infection. I know that it's E. coli. I know that it's resistant to these antibiotics and sensitive to those ones. If we can develop those kinds of tests, we could change that interaction right at the beginning. Or more importantly, we could stick a swab in somebody's nose and saying, thank you, you've got the cold virus. You need cold virus treatment. Go down to your friendly chemist and have a chat.
And maybe on your first question, certainly antibiotic stewardship, having common first choice, second choice, third choice approaches, you know, putting your top shelf antibiotics for your reserve agents. So certainly when you're giving what you've described there as empirical treatment, i.e. without any other results, certainly evidence-based methods of medicine, try to gather all the evidence that there is a bacterial infection while you've got the patient there. That's certainly what we teach our University of Adelaide veterinary science students. And then what is your best choice of antibiotic as a first choice without knowing what the agent is and its susceptibility profile. On the microbiota, that is a really big and important issue. And we have a grant in at the moment. Many of our producers are starting to see the amazing techniques we have to profile the gastrointestinal microbiota. There's plenty of evidence keeping it healthy and getting it healthy from the very start of life. Is there. I've got some very smart pig producers. They've put some money into a grant that we hope we get. They definitely want to keep antibiotic treatments as little as possible in that early stage life of the piglet. So certainly we've got some people really thinking, and if that takes off as a market driver, those guys will be ahead of the game.
Thank you. Okay, John, Biosecurity SA. John, you talked about passive surveillance and the high cost of targeted surveillance. I heard recently that Israel is experimenting with sampling in their sewage systems for viral pathogens. And I'm wondering whether that might be a technique to lower the cost of surveillance for resistant microbes.
Yes, in fact, that's a very good question. I'm meeting somebody for coffee just about that subject in 10 days' time. somebody from UniSA, no less. There has been some discussion about having some kind of surveillance in the environment, because as you would have got a flavour from all of our talks, is that antibiotic resistance is just everywhere. In fact, you are all carrying antibiotic-resistant bacteria in our guts as we sit here. Why? Because they've been around for 70 years and they've been mixing, but they're in the environment. So it's interesting to know just how much of a reservoir the environment is. We will find antibiotic resistance of the ordinary type in our sewerage. What's going to be more interesting is whether we can use that to detect carriage of these superbugs, the really critically important ones, our car alert type bugs that I showed, because we'll be able to figure out whether healthy people are carrying it and giving it to sick people later and getting illness that way. So there is considerable interest in doing that. The magic question, well, who's gonna pay?
To what extent is animal resistance passed to humans? Is it by ingestion of the animal products?
It could be, it could also be the fact that they've got the resistance genes that you're ingesting as well. We don't understand that mechanism particularly well, but we do know that resistance genes are just as contagious as the bacteria themselves. We know that they've worked out how to share resistance genes. But remember that those of you who are not taking antacids for your dyspepsia, that your gastric acid kills off just about everything, and it is good for you. And we do know that having good gastric acid is going to be a lifelong protection.
Most of our surveillance around the world in animals is focused on foodborne pathogens, salmonella and campylobacter. So the development of resistance in those is an issue. Particularly, say, children can't be treated with certain antibiotics, and if they're resistant, we reduce the choices. And salmonella can kill. Certainly, all of our surveillance is focused on that. But also, if you look at the animal production system, what we call the farm to fork or the paddock to plate, there are many stages of that production where we can try to reduce the risk of that foodborne organism coming through and also that foodborne organism acquiring antibiotic resistance. One of the methods we're using, of course, is Ecos4, a local produced company here. We're wanting to trial that as a carcass wash. So if we reduce the amount that's on a carcass, knowing that you cook meat, you know, the chances of getting that resistant infection lower each time.
There's one more here.
I've got one more question. First of all, for the veterinarian, how did you get the cat to eat the antibiotic? And second of all, at the end of the day, it's your body, so you should not have antibiotics just for the standard colds and coughs. But if you were to not take antibiotics, would the immune system get stronger or just be stabilised and stay as its immunity is? Does it actually get stronger?
So I'll go for the first, and which of my colleagues would go for the second? James, yeah, I think. it is very difficult to get a cat to take a pill. having a third child at home that is a diva, you know, I can't even get a pill down her. You know, oh, woe is me, what are you trying to do to me? A sick moriband cat, of course, is different, and you may be then treating with parenteral antibiotics like an injection, particularly if it's in hospital. In poor Frank's case, the upper respiratory tract infection he was treated with is a paste, specially formulated for cats. You can put it on their paw and they lick it. But then what we think is that may have destabilised his gut flora, and he may have had that salmonella that he carried into the shelter. This is all hypothetical. And then when he developed the salmonella infection and got really, really sick, you know, then it's very difficult to get oral medication into a cat like that. And you would be treating with parenteral antibiotics. He was treated with amoxicillin clavulanic acid, but he didn't respond because the bug was resistant to it. So it really was a case of fantastic veterinary care. All care was taken, diagnostic tests were done. But in this case, he was just a very unlucky cat. This was a really resistant bug. We still have no idea how it got into a cat's tummy. But it's the subject of research for us for the next few years.
As far as, so the other question was in relation to, so if you take antibiotics, you know, if you don't take them, will your immune system get stronger? Not specifically. What antibiotics can do is they can change the flora. Antibiotics aren't selective for just a pathogen. They'll take out the good bacteria, which are important for digestive health and things like that. It can also get rid of competing microflora. If you're talking about respiratory infection, it can get rid of competing microflora in the oropharynx, that sort of thing. So the antibiotics can give problems in terms of getting rid of the competition. And if it just happens that your bug is resistant and its competition was susceptible, then you're giving it, you're basically giving it the arena. But in terms of impact on the immune system per se, both the innate and the acquired immune system, then there wouldn't be significant impact by removing antibiotics from your life altogether.
Okay, we'll go with a couple more. I think there's one up here. Yep.
Hi, sorry, mine's a less technical question. I'm a teacher of biology in high schools for about 20 years, and I've been talking about antibiotic resistance for that long. It gets a bit scary with the young folk, and I'm just wondering if you've got any advice on, I mean, obviously they should be saying no to antibiotics or not asking for them when they have a cold, etc. But in the long term, what sort of future can they see, I suppose? You talked about vaccines. Is that possibly the way human health is going?
I think vaccines are only going to be developed for diseases which either are very substantial in terms of their severity, the classical example being at the moment being meningococcal disease, you know, where we're seeing cases coming around, and we've got the new vaccine for meningococcus group B in short supply globally because the company can't meet sort of production demands. But a meningococcal B vaccine is probably unlikely ever to be what we call cost effective, in that the cost of immunising the total population, you know, the susceptible population, is probably going to far outweigh the actual cost of managing the disease, you know, those who would otherwise have got the disease. There are some, so the case for using those sorts of vaccines are in the case of something which causes very, very severe disease. There's probably a better case for the pneumococcal vaccines because they are, you know, more common than meningococcus, and also they're causing a wider range of diseases, not just the life-threatening sepsis, but also pneumonias, non-bacterial pneumonias, middle ear infections and so on. So there probably is a better sort of cost recovery there. And it's also, that's the world's, current pneumococcal vaccine, which isn't working very well, is in fact the biggest selling vaccine in the world. I think sales of Prevnar are now something like $5 billion a year, I think, something like that. And so that's an example of a vaccine where the company is actually getting its investment back.
Just add a few points. I'm a bit of an optimist rather than a pessimist. I think anyone in the audience that has had a friend or even themselves have a life-threatening bacterial infection will know, thank God for antibiotics. For the future, science enrolments are down. We need more people coming in with a desire to say, I want to develop the next antibiotic. So certainly be very happy to talk to you about things we can do to get into your school and encourage people that it's not the end of the world, but we need scientists that are developed, you know, right the way from high school up into our science faculty that say, I want to develop the next super drug.
And politicians. Mark Boyd from University of Adelaide. Question for John and Darren, mainly. It's great news that we've got a national strategy to combat drug resistance. John, I remember you many years ago, it's got to be close to 30, on the 730 report, I think, passionately saying we needed this, so it must at least be satisfying. We do have one. But you've both mentioned that there will be pressure both in antibiotic use in animals in the region, and also we know some of these very resistant organisms like the New Delhi metallobetalactamase have come here from travel, and you mentioned migratory birds. So do we, even though we've got a national strategy, do we still leave, is there a problem with, you know, not really being able to address what's going on in the region, and do we need to engage with the region to try and, for our own protection, but also for people living in those countries as well?
Oh, look, there is a regional problem, but it's there's also agreement at the World Health Organization level that every country needs to be putting in the effort. The New Delhi metallobetalactamase story, the NDM story, it's a perfectly good example of the fact that once something goes out there and goes, I don't think the term's viral in this case, but but it did, that story, and what caused the Indian government great chagrin was the naming of it, but it was an Indian thing. or the Indian subcontinent at least, was that they suddenly had to pull their socks up. And they took the subject extremely seriously. And for a country that's got so many other problems to solve, they realised that this was going to put them into international shame territory if they didn't take some action. So that's fed into the WHO, we've got to do something about this. Every country's got to make a contribution. There's actually a program that WHO is rolling out, assessing every country's progress in terms of national strategies and implementation plans. It'll take years, if not decades, to go through the whole planet. But Australia's actually going to be reviewed this year. Where are we up to? And of course, I've showed you a very mixed picture in human health. We've got a better picture in animal health, but we can do a lot better. We can do an awful lot better. And we could stop beating ourselves up with overuse of antibiotics. We'd be doing the future health of this nation, planet, despite the fact that we all rush off and have holidays in India and pick up these bugs. When you come back to Australia, you get all the good bugs and they're all washed away again.
I think there's one more just there.
Just a query. First of all, the benefits of individuals using probiotics, and secondly, comments about the use of concerns about antibacterial sprays that are commonly used in households.
It's a big subject. Yeah, well, the probiotics are very interesting things. Everybody's desperately wanting to find probiotics that make a big difference. Certainly in terms of healthcare, there's only one example I know where probiotics have actually been demonstrably effective, and that's in neonates who develop diarrhoea, a very special form of diarrhoea. Conceptually, I think we will get there, because what we do now know is that antibiotics are not harmless. Every time you take a course of antibiotics, your good bacteria get beaten up, and they take weeks, if not months, to recover.
And just from the animal perspective, we've certainly found a number of probiotics have had a bit of a bad name. They've been a sort of a horses for courses, take this one and it'll fix everything. But with the new techniques we can do for profiling your bacteria in your gut very, very effectively with all the gene sequencing and techniques, we can now really assess the effect of that probiotic, you know, at the microbial level as well as at the production level. I've got some colleagues in the pig industry certainly getting very, very good results with using one particular type, and they've been sort of playing around with their system for years. But it takes a lot of research, and it's also a lot of risk. It's a lot of risk for a pig producer to suddenly take out their antibiotics and try to replace it with something that they consider more natural. 10% mortality, and suddenly he can't pay his staff. You know, he's losing pigs left, right, and centre. So, but we're certainly in a very interesting space for that in the future.
I think we might draw it to a close there. We're starting to lose some of the audience. Look, can I just thank you again for such great turnout tonight? I really do appreciate seeing so many people here. Could you first, we have a gift for each of the speakers here. I hope they're all the same, so there's no unseemly fights. So can you join me in thanking the speakers tonight for great presentations?